Auckland, New Zealand. I mean, where else do you find a pop group wearing grass skirts? The third leg of the Whitbread Around the World race is about to start, and so is my part in this adventure. This is the leg that will take us from New Zealand across the Southern Ocean to the legendary Cape Horn, and then up the Argentine coast to Punta del Este in Uruguay. Skip Novak, our captain, has insisted that everyone have 2 weeks of real holiday before this leg, which is a pretty good idea when you've sailed over 14,000 miles and been living out of each other's pockets on a boat that's only 77 feet long. Every small boat in Auckland is milling around in the harbour to see all the competitors off. I wave goodbye to my wife and say hello to a routine that won't change for the next 5 weeks. There's no special treatment for me. I'm a crew member and I work alongside the others. But for me, an extraordinary experience is about to begin.
Drum was bought as a shell in January 1985 and launched in June. With only 3 months to the start of the Round the World race, it was important that we do some serious racing to see how the boat performed. Other Maxis that were going to go around the world had been racing for a year or more, exploring the potential of their boats and welding a crew together into a unit. We had a lot of catching up to do. The Seahorse Maxi series was our first chance. The Solent dished up its usual balmy summer sailing weather, but Drum showed her pace, and we won the event. 10 days later, we set out on the Fastnet race.
Quite a heavy wind and quite a big sea, and of all things, the keel sheared off the boat. It took about 20-30 seconds to go actually turtle upside down. There were people trapped inside the hull, and people were in the water. And I think due to the teamwork, it is only due to the teamwork and professionalism and level-headedness of the crew that we are all 24 of us still alive today.
Luckily, someone on shore had seen Drum capsize, and a helicopter arrived after 40 minutes, bringing a diver who rescued those trapped inside. Drum was abandoned, and she floated for 2 days before she could be towed back to Falmouth. The start of the Around the World race was only 40 days away, and we had to decide if we wanted to continue. The boat was righted, and after a critical analysis, we thought we could get her ready in time. Apart from a new keel, we needed a new mast, new sails, and new electronics. Although three of the original crew dropped out, everyone's morale was high as we worked flat out to get her ready. 35 days later, with her new lead keel firmly bolted on, Drum was put back into the water, and the 100-foot spare mast was fixed into place. It was a great day.
I can't own enough gratitude for the people here, for everybody, the Moody's people especially. They've been, we slotted right back into the same shed, had the same guys on the job, and they've had 100% support for us. And I knew that we could do it. I was 100% confident that they would do it.
5 days later, on September the 28th, 1985, Drum prepared to sail 27,000 miles around the world. She'd been in the water only long enough to clock up 70 miles, and instead of a sea trial, she was going to sail the 7,000-mile length of the Atlantic. There were 15 yachts competing in the Whitbread, of which 7 were Maxis. Because of the different designs, no one really knew how the boats would square up against each other. Certainly no one knew what sort of challenge Drum would be.
Just coming up, any second now, I reckon.
Maxis are the giants of ocean racing. With their 80-foot hull and their 10-story masts carrying sails the size of 2 tennis courts, they are an image of unstoppable power. As we all headed down the Solent, Drum charged into the lead. We knew that the strain on the gear was going to be a constant worry, but we didn't expect a spinnaker to split only 20 minutes into the race. Drum slowed to a halt, and while the other boats tried to catch up, we changed the spinnaker in 90 seconds. It's a long 5-week haul down to Cape Town on Leg 1, best described as a 7,000-mile obstacle course of weather systems. There are big gains or big losses to make, as we painfully found out as early as off the northwest corner of Spain. On the strength of a weather forecast, a few of the Maxis split tactics and diverged from the course in hopes of being the first to pick up a predicted southwesterly, moving in from a deep low in mid-Atlantic. On Drum, we opted for the direct track near the Iberian Peninsula, banking on finding a strong, local following wind known as the Portuguese Trades. It was a bad move, as the northerlies never materialized for us. Boats like Line and UBS, who went west, caught the new wind, and by the time we were off the coast of Morocco 3 days later, had jumped over 100 miles ahead of us. We felt better by the time we reached the halfway mark in the fickle winds of the doldrums, as the leaders had stopped first and we'd caught up. Getting south into the trade winds, the weather worsened steadily. There were reports of Force 9 gales rounding the Cape, and later, when we hit them, the Maxi started to break up. The pounding sea conditions had split the laminations of the fiberglass hull in the port bow sections, and it was obvious to everyone that if the hull breached, she would go down in a jiffy. Every one of us must have lent a thought to the life raft situation. 2 weeks before, one of our two 10-man rafts had accidentally inflated due to a faulty gas cylinder. I didn't relish the idea of fitting 17 men in a 10-man raft, or the skipper's duty of deciding who would if they all couldn't. At a slow speed, we limped in the direction of the shore in hopes of reaching the small fishing port of Luderitz in Namibia. Code Dor, who reported similar problems with delamination, also had to slow down, but continued south. And Privateer, when only 220 miles from the finish and leading the fleet, lost her mast and turned for Luderitz. Luckily, 48 hours later, the wind and seas had eased off. We immediately undertook makeshift repairs and shored up the flexing sections with floorboards and aluminum tubing. We scrubbed the Luderitz plan and headed once again for Cape Town in the finish. Privateer had managed to make Luderitz and erect a sewer pipe as a jury-rig mast, but this broke after only 12 hours during her last bid to make the finish under sail. They motored into Cape Town, which disqualified them from the leg. Code Dor had made it as well as NZI, also suffering mass damage. And we limped in at last, 2 days behind the leg winner UBS Switzerland. In Cape Town, we had 3 weeks to haul her out of the water and make our repairs. While other crews took a break, we worked day and night to get Drum ready for the next leg. With the crew's morale at rock bottom, they needed a bit of a pep talk.
If it's a dead calm for the last week before we start the second leg, we race the boat hard, we get 10 days out, the thing starts to move around, come adrift again or whatever, and we have to accept the fact that we may have to retire and pull into Perth, pull into Hobart, Christ knows where. So I think it's up to the individual to look for his own guidance or salvation.
So there's just the four of us doing the next leg.
That's how I viewed it, and that's how I kind of explained things to the crew and how we all looked at it in the end. But never getting away from that, when you set out and the wind starts to blow and the boat heels over, and you immediately think, is this thing going to be okay? I thought the worst that could happen was that the repair we did wouldn't be 100% correct, and we'd show signs of movement again or something not quite right, and we'd have to drop out maybe in Perth or Hobart. I didn't think the boat was going to sink. I would have never started out if I thought that.
The second leg of the race is notorious for bad weather, and this time was no exception. It took 29 days to sail the 7,100 miles to New Zealand, and in spite of a rugged passage and heavy reaching conditions, Drum finished a credible fourth place. The news story of the leg was the pitched duel between NZI and Privateer, who went the entire distance neck and neck to finish an incredible 7 minutes apart in Auckland. But for us, the important thing was that the repair worked, and at last we were back in the race. Leg 3 is 6,200 miles from Auckland to Punta del Este. It was difficult to leave the warmth and the hospitality of New Zealand. On that first night out at the beginning of Leg 3, there were some glum thoughts about the prospect of another cold bout with the Southern Ocean. It was over 4,000 miles to Cape Horn, and we were sure to encounter some heavy weather on the way. But the crew were fresh and keen to push Drum once again to her limit.
And
Any doubts that I had about settling down with 18 men had been unnecessary. We were like a sort of family. Sometimes the atmosphere was professional, sometimes it was an atmosphere of comradeship, sometimes it was just plain silly. In a race like this, there's no such thing as a good night's sleep. You're on watch for 4 hours, and you sleep for 4 hours, and then you're on watch again for 4 hours. You get into somebody else's bed, soggy, and you get out damp. And so it goes on and on, around the clock, for weeks.
UBS, drop from UBS, over.
My position this morning is south, 4205 south, 17739 west. I say again, 17739 west. What's yours, over?
Roger, drop position 4205 and 17739. It's correct, over.
It's very correct, Pierre. Over.
We were kept in touch with race control by the Argos system, which is a satellite system. We have a small little antenna that we carry on the stern of the boat. It's a little plastic dome with an antenna inside. It's totally self-contained, has its own battery. And that sends signals up to a satellite, and the satellite will pinpoint the position of the boat. And that is telephoned through to the race committee, and that happens twice daily, and that's made public. Anybody from the public can call up to the race committee and find out where we are.
For the first 4 days, the weather had been hot, and the wind was perfect. Then we hit the cold. As we dived south, the air temperature fell to 2 or 3 degrees, and with the wind chill factor, it went below freezing. A lot of the time, the wind was forward of the beam, which meant the cold seas coming continuously over the bows. And after 4 hours of facing into that foul coldness, it was a relief to get below for some rest and some warmth. There were wet sailbags constantly being dragged about, and the air was damp and smelly. Movement is difficult because the boat throws you about, and even getting dressed or undressed is a major physical struggle. With the sails being repaired on the sewing machine, the generator roaring, the sound of winches clattering and the constant pounding of the waves, no consideration was given to those trying to sleep. Wet and cold from being on watch, we would get into bunks that were damp and chilly. It didn't matter. Sleep was the most important thing, and we were so tired, we slept the sleep of the dead. Racing flat out in the Southern Ocean is the ultimate sailing experience. When it blows really hard, the westerly gales build up huge following seas, and often the boat takes off on a surf at well over 20 knots. The best speed we hit officially was 29 knots. I think it was more than that. On the edge of control, we needed 2 men on the helm to keep the boat on track, and there was constant apprehension about whether or not the gear could take it. NZI lost her mast on this leg, and a year's preparation and 15,000 miles of racing went out the window. In our enthusiasm to go faster, we had to remind ourselves about the dangers of falling overboard. A man who goes over the side down here is as good as dead. It is almost impossible to stop the boat before he either drowns or dies from hypothermia. The 3 lives that have been lost in the previous Whitbreads were all lost in this ocean.
observing from a distance this morning, you would have seen absolute catastrophe at about 10 to 4.
If you can imagine the boat sailing along downwind and you get turned 90 degrees, all the wind just turns the boat, lays it flat over on its side, and you can do that obviously in both directions. If you do it in the direction of the wind, towards the wind, it's a broach, and if you do the other way, it's a flying jibe, Chinese jibe, what they call. All things can break, and the spinnaker pole usually breaks, and it's quite violent. You usually blow out the spinnaker, blow out the mainsail perhaps, possibly lose the mast. It's something you never want to do.
She lay on her side for 2 minutes while those on watch clung to the vertical deck, and those off watch remembered the Fastnet capsize. Drum righted herself, but a sailbag had got entangled around the propeller, and its drag was slowing us down. Mickey, an experienced Swedish Navy diver, went overboard to cut it off, but the freezing water soon left him breathless, and because of a small technical mistake, he ended up being keel-hauled right under the boat. The water knocked his face mask off, and when he finally surfaced the other side of the boat, he didn't have the strength to get back out of the water. Then he lost consciousness. We finally managed to drag him aboard, and were relieved to find him still breathing. So he was given the rest of the day off.
And we lost about 16 miles in the process. Not a very good day. Now we have the storm shoot up again and going for it.
The real hazard down here is icebergs. Unlike the Titanic, we had radar, and the big bergs, some of which are miles long and have been floating around in circles here for decades, were easy to spot and avoid. But the most miserable job on the boat was standing up at the bow looking out for the little bergs, growlers, which are the size of a car, and if a boat hits one, you sink instantly. And then one morning, the heavy seas were gone, and the sun came out for the first time in 19 days, and we all came on deck and stared at it. We took advantage of the fine weather to do some running repairs and to dry out.
Bit of an anticlimax, really, to be 160 odd miles from Cape Horn and it to be almost not warm but not freezing cold. Still, might have something in store for us yet, who knows?
A little bit more.
Fine. You dream about it being really fierce weather down there and then it's like this, the sun comes out. Especially when you hear that it's minus one in England.
Some of the crew needed repairs as well.
It's not ideal circumstances. You need
can sleep a little while. When you wake up, it will be very hard and you will be very happy.
And we're hoping to see land maybe late this evening before it gets dark over in that direction there. Should see the snow-capped mountains of the Cordillera Darwin, which is the highest land in and around Cape Horn. But it's a beautiful day. It's getting warmer. Reaching along with a jib top here. Beautiful day's sail.
Who'd have thought we'd be here now?
You didn't expect to be here, did you?
Not the day we turned upside down. I certainly didn't. And there in the distance now is Cape Horn. Fantastic. The big black rock.
At the Horn, we offered Neptune a toast in the traditional way. And after weeks of eating freeze-dried food and total alcoholic abstinence, one glass of this stuff and you're seeing things.
How did all these reporters get on board?
All right.
Good one.
Paul.
Thank you.
Roger, navigator, who got us here, but didn't let us get close enough to get decent pictures.
It's strong,
you haven't been drunk any yet, you're already falling over.
And porno.
See the lighthouse now.
You and I, Magnus.
All right.
Back to the Atlantic.
Yeah, right.
Where we come from.
This is the corner, guys, we're going north.
After the Horn, it's another 1,500 miles against the wind to the finish in Punta del Este. Again, the fleet split tactically near the Falkland Islands, and we took the western option, looking for the new wind first.
Whispered out loud. Your breeze doesn't bend. We're lying in the palm of your hand. No land we see, no place to be. The salt of your tears has stained to our hearts. There's no long years can tear us apart. Our futures entwined with your hearts.
UBS, suspecting we were up to something, came back across to cover us just before the wind died, and we all stopped.
Blow, gray lady, blow your ship back home. Blow, gray lady.
We sat and waited for 18 hours. Then, right on cue, the westerlies came in and we set off at 13 knots.
Blow, gray lady, blow your ship back home.
one of the best days we've had on Drum. Privateer in Condor about 10 miles behind, 10, 12 miles behind. Punta del Este about 11 miles ahead. Looks like nothing can go wrong, but you never know. Could go light in there. We're hoping it goes light just after we finish because we got line about 160 miles astern this morning, and we need all the hours we can on them to catch up. They're 42 hours ahead at the end of leg two. So we're feeling pretty good.
Fantastic. Even the sun's out. The bird's going for home.
Just kind of steer on a pointy hand, just to the left of that island. Okay. Just to the right in that corner, okay?
Cruising now, guys.
A real slow.
It was a tremendous arrival. UBS had arrived 12 hours before us, but we had gained over the rest, especially Lion, whom we beat by 24 hours. This meant that we only had 18 more hours to gain on her to recoup the two lost days off Cape Town and finish second overall. We were so happy with Drum's performance, and especially that of Skip the captain and Rogers as navigator, that we threw them into the sea.
For the four-week layover in Punta, we were able to relax. Instead of tasteless, freeze-dried food, we ate fresh South American beef and drank plenty of beer, and were given the run of the local country club where the crew of Lion organized a day of competitive sports for all the crews. Luckily, the Drum team won the event, and our morale received another boost. 2 days later, we set out on the last leg back to England. We had 600 miles to gain the 18 hours needed to capture second place from our arch rival Lion on that fourth and last leg. As expected, in the upwind battle to the equator, she fought to stay inside of us for 7 days. It wasn't until we were near the Brazilian coast that squally weather, just below the doldrums, gave us a chance to slip away in the bad visibility.
What are you doing, Phil?
We're having a scrub down. We're having the morning scrub down. Loose down. Wait!
There we go. The
says the human body loses its own weight of hair in its lifetime.
Yeah.
And it all goes on the bloody boat.
Yeah. More living organisms on the human skin than there are people in the world. They got nowhere to go on this boat except on the decks.
We are leading these boats!
Crossing the equator by trial is what every uninitiated seaman faces. King Neptune came over the bows as expected to test three of our crew and eventually gave us permission to cross back into the Northern Hemisphere.
When did we last see Halley's Comet?
A week ago.
Wrong, last night. Give him some. All right.
I know, Don.
Having endured the secret and appalling initiation ceremony for those crossing the equator for the first time, we entered what was for me the best part of the race.
This is gorgeous. It looks like they are flying, you know, in the air.
Yeah. It's so easy for them, isn't it?
Looks nice here, doesn't it?
Beautiful. This is what makes you feel lucky, you know, when you see dolphins. I think that's one of the great things about this race is the amount of wildlife we've seen.
These are the trade winds now. Everyone else seems to agree that we're out of all of that messy weather now. So we're looking forward to a good week, at least a week of this on the wind, some sunshine in the trade winds. Hopefully we can gain a few more miles on Lion and maybe catch up UBS a little bit.
The light winds in the high-pressure system near the Azores would be the last obstacle the fleet would face before the finish. It was Drum's last chance to somehow get those hours on Lion. We skirted its western edge while Lion and Cote d'Or gambled on breaking through the center.
Geographically, we are at about 28 degrees north and 33 west. We're just south and slightly to the west of the Azores, and it's really exciting at the moment because the weather's changing every hour or so, and just on these changes, it depends who gets that little bit of advantage to get back to Portsmouth first. Over.
Good luck. We just crossed. Let's have a whisper, Drum. Over and out.
Drum clear. Over and out.
Although we kept our lead, the high moved off and released line and cote d'or from the calm weather, and we all sailed into the English Channel in steady winds. The game was all but finished.
Something a little ditty that we do on the amidships when the sun's rising and setting, in fact. Try a little bit of this exercise. Most of the boys claim that they do enough exercise when they're in the bunks down below.
We're just surrounded by sharks, Roger. We're not quite sure whether they're man-eating sharks or plankton-eating sharks.
What about that one that was right down next to the boat here?
It was close, I tell you what. I was a bit alarmed. You just see this huge jaw snapping furiously, and then a fin touched the side of the stanchion.
Saw its jaws.
Big. 10 minutes before that, just had a whale leap out of the water, about 20 feet in front of the boat.
Completely
out of the water. Came out, did a half roll, and went back down again, just right in front of the boat.
Was that a whale, do you think, not a shark?
That was definitely a whale. Definitely a whale. And then he came out again, just behind the stern. Big?
How big?
Very big.
As we entered the western approaches to the channel and sailed along the south coast of Cornwall, the Navy sent out a helicopter to see if we were going to need rescuing again, I suppose. But after 27,000 miles, those dark days seemed a long, long way off indeed.
I think the result's very good. If it hadn't been for the fact that we lost 2 days on the first leg, we'd be in second position. And so I think that we should be very happy that we've succeeded to get third, considering the problems we've had. We're lucky to still be in the race at all, over.
As a crew, we had raced and worked together for nearly a year. At 5 a.m. on Sunday, May the 10th, 1986, we crossed the finishing line in third position. It was over.
I have a measuring stick now. I have something very simple and very straightforward and very honest, by which I can sort of compare other things in my life.
It's one of those things that when you think back on it, it'll give me a lifetime of thoughtful pleasures.
Both legs were fantastic, absolutely. What can I say? I've been halfway around the world on a boat which doesn't have an engine running.
For me, the big pleasure is the people side of things. The owners have been great. Mike, Paul, and Simon have been great, and the crew have been fantastic. And you know, it's really a happy bunch of guys we've got here.
People don't remember who comes second and third. Well, not for very long, anyway. I think that we might do it again.
Now, having done it once, would you want to do it again?
I probably will in a couple of years. I don't right now.
I gather that's what they all say there.
Well, not tomorrow, but in 4 years' time, I'd definitely do it again.
I'd definitely do it again. Definitely.
Your breeze doesn't bend. We're lying in the palm of your hand. No land we see, no place to be. The salt of your tears have stained to our hearts. There's no long years can tear us apart. Our futures entwined with your past. Because when we lie awake, we'll be thinking of you, love. Pray, lady, blow your ship back home, blow. Pray, lady. Because when we lie asleep, we'll be dreaming of you, love. Because one day we'll return, and you'll be waiting for us.